All right, welcome today, everyone. This is Tuesday, 31st of March, end of the first quarter, and moving forward with Reboot and Thrive. So today, I want to introduce somebody who is very special, near and dear to my heart, and that is Regine Nelson. As you all know, this is Christopher Nelson, and I am with Wealthward Capital. Wealthward Capital helps technology professionals build passive income producing portfolios. And my wife and my business partner, she runs Wealthward Realty, which is?
Wealthward Realty is a Austin-based real estate brokerage that primarily helps tech employees diversify their portfolio through active investments. So when you think active, single family homes, quadplexes, duplexes, all the way up to commercial property, and even those that want to get involved in Airbnbs.
Thank you very much. And we do have to confess, whenever Regine and I, we confessed in our first video that we made up the word wealth word. If you haven't seen that video, go check it out on my YouTube channel. Today, we want to confess that we're not live, and that'll actually probably lead into, that will lead into what we're going to talk about today, because Regine actually has a transaction. She's going out. She will be safe, but she has a transaction, so she needs to go to an inspection. So we're recording this early, and we will be online doing some chatting and other things, but thank you for accepting this as live, but not live.
That's right.
Okay. That's right. So I want to just, again, recap, Reboot and Thrive. We are here mm-hmm. to help you go through this reboot and thrive through this. And so week one is we talked about, we're walking through really our core values and principles here of build wealth, live well, make an impact. This is day two of build wealth. Yesterday, I walked you through five strategies that you can execute right now to help you start building wealth right now. And so go back and refer to that. Today, we really want to talk about active investing strategies. This is why Regine is here. She is our expert here in Austin of helping us understand how do we navigate what is happening right now with active real estate investing, people who are buying homes. She manages our personal portfolio of single family homes and Airbnbs, and she's going to touch on that today. But I thought we'd start off with, what's the state of the union for either residential home buyers or investors?
Well, the state of the union right now, you guys, is a bit of a challenge. Everything is in flux and there's a lot of uncertainty. But what you can be certain about is that people are still looking for homes, they're still needing homes, and investors are still out there looking. So it's important to keep that in mind. While we will see a slow in transactions are still happening on a daily basis. Real estate is an industry that really can't be stopped. And so it's not going to stop. It's going to slow down, possibly significantly, but it's not going to stop. In terms of residential, what we're seeing, especially in Texas and in some of the southern states, as right now is really the prime time for either selling your home or buying a home, right? The majority of transactions happen between the month of March all the way up to July. Transactions happen after that period and outside of that window, of course, but the bulk of them happen during this time, as with mortgages as well. What we're seeing as a whole is that in the first 90 days of this year, as a result of the coronavirus and the scares that it's posed to people, both financially as well as physically, we've seen that in the first 90 days of this year, we've seen the most transactions happen, right? So in a 365 day period, we've done that amount of loan originations in a 90 day window. So that means that the mortgage industry in the United States is in hyperdrive, is in overload. So what we're seeing across the board is that the government and brokers are raising the minimum requirements to qualify for a loan. So that means that if you were not in a transaction currently, so that means you weren't in escrow, you weren't moving towards closing, depending on how far away you are from that, if you are not hyper-qualified, over-qualified for that, you may not be able to close that transaction. But the good news is there are still a ton of people that are very qualified to close on transactions, and the transactions will continue.
I just want to just step in right there. So what I'm hearing you say is that it all of a sudden transactions, what would normally happen in the year, happen in the first 90 days. So
for mortgages, yes.
For mortgages. And so they're putting the brakes on that. That's sort of slowing down a little bit.
They're slowing that. They're trying to mitigate it because the industry, the systems, the banks were not built for this, right? So they were built for a certain amount of transactions. And since we've exceeded that, they really have to pull the reins on that to allow the system to kind of read. So as you saw at the end of last year, at the beginning of this year, interest rates were in the threes, right? What's happening now is that supply and demand, right? A lot of people are looking to either refi their homes to get into a better position. They're looking to take out cash, right, in order to hold on to that. And you have the regular transactions that are happening from the traditional buyers, as well as some investors. They need to cull that, right? Mm-hmm. They need to provide more opportunities for everyone. So the interest rates are going up high because we have so many people looking to get into HELOCs, refinances, that they're saying, okay, there's a lot of demand, not a lot of supply. So now we're at about a 4.25 right now. And that will change as they implement these measures. Things are going to start slowing down in about a month or so, potentially, in another 4 or 5 months, we will see the historically low rates, although rates are still historical because in the 1980s, they were at 15, 18%. So we're still at historical lows today.
That's great. And so I think what I'm hearing, especially for residential investors residential home buyers is reach out, talk to your agent, understand what's happening, because it sounds like with these minimum requirements in flux, people need to understand immediately, like what's going to happen to me and how is this going to impact me?
Right. And then the other way, the real estate industry is being impacted is not just in the mortgages. It's also in the way that the transactions are done, right? So Christopher and I were married, so we don't need to keep that, for right now, right? He's not infected. I'm not infected. We don't need to keep that 6 feet of distance apart from each other. But in doing transactions, it's hard to sit across the table from someone and be 6 feet away. It's hard to do a showing with someone and be 6 feet away. So they're moving into virtual showings, virtual closings, virtual notaries, and all of that, right? What that means for new listings, especially for investors that are looking to, that had fix and flip projects in flight. That means that you better take some really good photos of that by yourself if you can't get a photographer out there, right? So lighting is going to be important, angles are going to be important, and the quality of your camera is going to be important. But you definitely need to make sure that you have photos and videos that represent the property well, because that's the way that the majority of the buyers are going to be able to see it. So definitely taking that into account, lock boxes, particularly those that are combo lock boxes, so that potential tenants can go into a vacant property or potential buyers can go into a vacant property on their own to assess that property and see if it's worth purchasing for them. Again, this is for showings of vacant properties because that's what is allowed right now. Occupied properties are going to have to wait until the tenants move out.
So can our lock boxes still being used right now? And is there a protocol around using those?
There's different protocols about using those. If you have an agent, they'll be able to give you some guidelines on doing that. But if you manage the property yourself, the best way to do that is going to be to get just your standard combo lockbox, 4 numbers, 10 numbers. Some of them use letters even. As long as you use a combination lockbox, not a Supra or a Sentry lock that realtors use, because then you'll need a realtor or another real estate agent to be able to open that door with their credentials for a potential tenant or for a potential buyer. I'm talking about the kind that you can buy at your local Home Depot.
Okay.
That's $10.
And so I think we started transitioning. So residential, it sounds like there's a lot going on, especially for loans. Transactions are happening.
Yes.
And it sounds like then the interaction is going to be a lot more virtual between you and your agent. And then even you may go and walk the property by yourself.
Right.
And those types of things. But let's click quickly to let's walk over to investments. And if somebody has a portfolio of active investments, what are the things that they can do right now to start shoring up that investment and understanding how they can weather the storm? And what's your advice on managing that investment?
Yeah. Well, number one is to definitely take a survey of your properties, right? If you are not a active investor that self-manages your properties, you want to really pull together a list and say, this is how many properties I have. These are the number of tenants that are in them. These are the properties that I'm managing myself. These are the properties that I have a property manager looking after for me. So you definitely want to just create a sort of a one sheet of what is the status of your properties, where they are located, and create a diagram, you know, especially with the states that they're located in and the cities, right? How many cases of the virus are happening? So just overall assessment, number one, of your properties. Number two is you need to contact your tenants in whatever way that is, whether it's you contacting them yourself because you self-manage, or your property manager sending out notifications. And property managers, as of late, have been really good about doing that, but you do not want to assume. You want to make sure, get on the phone with your property manager and make sure that they've sent out a communication to the tenants and kindly ask them for a copy of that correspondence. You want to have that for your records because you want to make sure that, number one, that they're saying things that you agree with, obviously. And number two, you want to make sure that communication has gone out. The thing that you do not want to happen is you do not want to wait to communicate with these tenants, right? And the communication is going to be fairly simple. It's going to be, number one, you know, acknowledging their well-being and what's happening right now, right? Making sure that they are sheltering in place, whatever those requirements are for their town, right? Making sure that they are safe and they are not experiencing any symptoms. And then number two, you know, preempting them, right? Providing them with the resources that they need, whether it's the links or the actual, you know, PDF documents that you attach that where they can apply and collect resources, but definitely showcasing that particular thing for them. What happens in times of uncertainty and fear is that people tend to lock up. So while your tenants may be looking at the news, they may not be connecting the dots and saying, this is something that I need to do right away, right? So with the stimulus package that was just signed earlier this week, what we need to do is if those tenants are unemployed or underemployed, right? So they have lost a significant portion of their income, even though they're receiving some benefits right from their employer, they need to apply as soon as they can for unemployment benefits federally, and then as well as for their states. In some instances, those are two different links. So I'm going to recap real quick. What we want to do is we want to assess our property landscape and situation. Where are they? How is that area being affected? Who is managing those properties? And number two, what we want to do is we want to reach out to those tenants, be it ourselves or to have our property managers reach out to those tenants and really make sure that that they have been communicated to. The third thing that we want to do that I'm going to leave you with is, you know, you've taken a landscape view of what your properties are, where they are, and how they're doing. You've had a chance to communicate with your tenants. The next step and the final step is to communicate with your mortgage lenders. Right now is the time to see, are you over leveraged? Are you under leveraged, right? Mm-hmm. Will you suffer a loss if your tenants can only pay half, right? Half of the mortgage payment, right? Whether that's the PITI all inclusive, right? Which is the principal, interest, tax, and insurance. Or if you don't have those escrowed, will you be able to cover that mortgage balance? What are some of the things that they can do to help you? Once you have a clear picture of that and you've explained the situation, they're being very accommodating right now, you guys. So the earlier you do this, and I do apologize because you probably will have a longer than normal wait time, because I guarantee it, you're not the only one that's looking to speak to your mortgage provider to seek some sort of forbearance or relax in the payments, right? So you definitely want to do that. And once you've done that, you'll have a clearer picture to decide what you want to do with the properties. Can you afford to hold them? How much savings do you have if you need to float the properties for a little while? If you feel that you're going to get into a situation where you will be underwater, then I would advise you to work with your local real estate agent or other investor that may be interested in your property to quickly dispose of that, because you don't want to come to a situation where you have no other options. And the coronavirus epidemic that's been going on doesn't have a clear end in sight. So you want to preemptively look to mitigate that risk sooner rather than later. And that's only if you're underwater, right? Because we're buy and hold investors. So I'm not going to advocate for you to get rid of your property unless it's absolutely necessary.
Wow. There was a lot there. I would encourage you, if you need to, right, we'll have the recordings online. You can walk through that. So there was definitely a lot there from a strategy perspective and how you're actually analyzing your property. I think what I'd like to do right now, though, is, Regine, is, you know, for yourself, as somebody who also actively manages properties, you are in direct connection with tenants. Help me understand, what are the, you know, 3 to 5 things, like when you're having a conversation with a tenant, and you're trying to understand, okay, you know, can this person pay? Can they pay some? And there's negotiation and there's tactics that you can execute to try and continue to move the property forward. What are those tactics that you're executing on right now? Please give some of that to our listeners.
Yeah. Well, number one, when you're communicating with the tenant, you definitely want to start off with an email that kind of lays out, you know, as I said earlier, a couple of things, right? So basically 3 things you want to lay out in that email. Number one, you want to, you know, reaffirm that there is a crisis happening right now, right? In terms of the coronavirus, COVID-19, you want to make sure that they're safe. Number two, you want to provide them with those resources that they may be able to use should they need them. And then number three, the last bullet is you want to touch upon if they are having an issue in paying their rent, that they need to contact you immediately. You don't want to put too much information in that email communication, but what it does is it gives them some written communication about, and it leaves a trail, sort of a breadcrumb that you've sent out that communication to them should anything happen and legal ramifications in the future, right? So you always want to protect. The follow-up is, in the next 48 hours, you need to contact every single tenant that you've sent that letter to. Number one, to make sure that they've received that email and to let them know that it was an urgent email, to kind of recap what was in the email. And you want to touch base with them. When you get on the phone, you don't want to start off with, "Hey, did you get that email that I sent?" No. "How are you? You know, how are you doing? How is your family?" You should really be looking to build a connection with them to make sure that they understand that the reason for your calling them, for sending out the email, is sincere. Okay. So once you've, you know, built that rapport with them, you know, checked in on them, how are their parents? How are their kids? How are they doing, right, with all of this? What are they thinking? Then you can sort of move into the next phase of the conversation, which is seeing, you know, have you been affected, you know, by what's been going on with the coronavirus, COVID-19? Has it affected your job? You know, is anyone in your household an essential worker? Is there anything that we can do to help you? Do you have enough toilet paper? Lighten it up, right? Because this is a serious conversation that you're having, and they'll be able to give you more information. You don't want to leave the call without understanding, number one, if they've been affected by this, and number two, if they may potentially be affected by this in the future. So for example, we have a tenant that I sent out the letter to, I contacted them. When I got on the phone, you know, they told me that they were doing okay for now, but they had some concerns about their employment. And so I told them to touch base with me and, you know, let me know if anything changes. Well, a few days later, they sent me a message and they said, "You know what? I actually just lost my job. I'm going to get a week or two of severance pay, and then I'll be able to apply for benefits." But here's the kicker. Here's what he told me. He said, "Even though I wasn't a practicing nurse for a number of years, I still kept my license active. So I have a way to be able to get a job, again, working as a nurse." And so I was very, very pleased by that. And these are things that I wouldn't have known, even looking at his history, because he hadn't been a practicing nurse for 5 years. That wasn't in the application form that he filled out when he signed up to be a tenant. And so you definitely want to understand what your tenant's capabilities are in a legal way you want to ask these questions, but also, you know, what are their prospects for the future, right? A lot of the tenants that you may have, especially in B and C class, will probably be non-essential workers that will not be able to work from home, right? So some of you will have the tenants that work in, even though they're B and C class, they work at the grocery store, they work in in the utilities field, right? So those are essential jobs that they have. So you definitely wanna know what's going on with your tenants when you talk to them. So after you've spoken to them and you've given them the resources, there are a couple of options that you can share with them if they are unable to pay rent. One thing that I wanna make clear is that I've been seeing a lot of people talking online and in some groups about how they plan to use the security deposit to kind of bump up the rents for the tenants. In the state of Texas, that is illegal.
I'm sorry, so you said they're going to use the deposit to bump up the rent?
They're using the security deposit to buffer the low rent payment. So for example, if a tenant can only pay 50% of the rent, they're going to take half of the security deposit to buffer the missing portion of the rent.
Right.
That is illegal. In the state of Texas.
In the state of Texas.
Yeah, and you need to check with your local tenant and property, not rights, but the law surrounding tenant and property law, because in the state of Texas, at least, security deposits are to be held in a trust account. Those are only to be touched when the tenant moves out of the property. It cannot be used to pay the last month's rent. It is paid for damages and it is returned to the tenant, and you have to have a detailed report as to what deductions you made once you return that security deposit to the tenant. It is the tenant's money, but they cannot use it towards rent.
Got it. So what I'm hearing you say, sorry to cut you off, but what I'm hearing you say is there are some tactics that are coming out that may not be applicable for everyone. So don't take it as law, but I think first and foremost, engage with your tenants, understand the situation, go through your portfolio. And this is what I was talking yesterday in a portfolio review is, as we looked at our single family homes and what we own, we went through and did an analysis and understanding what is the risk. And, you know, we are long-term buy and hold for our single family homes. And so we want to ensure that we have a clear path forward, you know, because when you look at a portfolio, if you have, you know, 10 homes and you have seven that are doing well that you know, are full paying and some that are partial paying, as a portfolio manager, you can then manage the other two through that. I think what Regine is saying is, you know, look at your portfolio, talk with your tenants, understand the situation in each one, and we may be in a month-to-month scenario. I think the other thing I heard clearly is, as people are coming out with strategies and ideas, be very careful as to what you're thinking of executing on, because you need to understand what your state and local laws are, because somebody may be advocating for something that's, you know, fine in, you know, Oklahoma or fine in Nebraska or, you know, but is not allowed in other places. So be careful there. I want to keep the conversation moving, Regine, and I want to talk about, you know, what should people think about from their Airbnb perspective, people who are Airbnb owners like ourselves?
Yeah, so we're Airbnb owners. And funny enough, I had a conversation with two Airbnb owners yesterday, one in Florida and another one here in the Austin area. And they were looking to add more Airbnbs to their portfolio and have quickly decided to pivot, such as we are pivoting. Depending on the type of Airbnb you have, I would highly suggest that you look at least for the next 4 to 6 months, get in a long-term tenant if you can. So that way you can have some income coming in. The alternative to that is to actually see, and Airbnb provides this as an option that you can do as well. I would definitely look into medical staff and medical personnel that are, or essential workers that are looking for additional space, because what you'll find is that as I was scrolling through Facebook this morning, one of our friends who is they're not an essential worker, but they can work remotely. They have twins that are less than a year old. Their husband is an endocrinologist I'm sorry, anesthesiologist, and he is an essential worker. And so in order to not infect his family, he took out temporary lodging so that he can have a space to reside, right? It's completely separate from his family so that he can protect them. And he literally, after dinner is when he sees his family for about 15 minutes. He stands across the street and he waves to his twins who desperately want him to hold them, but he just can't do that right now. So for the protection of his family. So definitely looking to offer highly discounted rates to people that are in that particular situation that need to quarantine themselves from their family, and then to medical professionals that are either coming in because they're traveling. So for example, in the New York area, lots of nurses are flooding there, but they still need places to live. And I beg you, because one of my nursing friends and on the nursing boards was saying how some landlords and some tenants are evicting and kicking out their tenants that are, number one, essential workers, and number two, that have coronavirus, COVID-19. Do not do that. I implore you, these people still need a place to live. They need a safe place where they can lay their heads and they can get ready to go out and go back out and do that work. So please do not, I repeat, do not evict, do not remove anyone that is suffering from the illness in your properties or who may have come in contact with people that are in your properties because that is illegal and it's also just wrong.
Well, and I think what you mentioned earlier is strategies are, you know, you want to then start talking to everybody, all of your vendors, your lenders, helping them understand the situation. So it's not that you're taking on the burden yourself. What I hear you say is number one, don't evict. I mean, this is really coming from the top down and really start partnering with other people to understand what are the tools that you have in your tool belt so that we can come together and help those people.
Right.
Excellent. So I know that you wanted to touch on, I think you may have already mentioned a little bit on fixing and flipping and wholesaling as we're just sort of walking down, you know, what investors do. I think what I heard you say is Airbnb, if you have standalones, you know, look to get renters in there 4 to 6 months. Then you also mentioned, you know, the short-term housing. Where can people find out more about that if they want to learn about how do they open up their Airbnbs to medical professionals?
You're looking specifically at Airbnb. Airbnb on their main page under your host profile, there'll be some information there. It should pop up clearly. It'll just say COVID-19 relief. There'll be an area where you can donate. And obviously, Airbnb allows you to also provide your space for no cost as well.
Excellent.
And they're waiving fees when they do that, by the way. And then you mentioned the fixing and flipping. If you have any projects in flight and you are a fix and flipper, finish it in areas that you can. There is a pause right now in the Austin area for construction in order to create that space so that way people can quarantine themselves for a number of weeks. So whatever you can finish, please finish that, but do not take on any more fix and flip properties. Resources, being able to get vendors and contractors out is going to be very difficult. So I would not advise that you add more fix and flip deals to your properties unless, number one, they are vacant and they're significantly discounted and you are buying cash and you can afford to hold on to them until this coronavirus, this epidemic is has run its course. In terms of wholesalers, so wholesalers right now, that's another way that you can actively invest, looking at properties to get a deal on them. If you are a wholesaler, you can still be out there looking for properties. If you are looking to acquire wholesale deals, you can still do that. But remember, whatever numbers that you were using before, you want to create a higher threshold for the properties that you acquire. So if you are looking to buy properties that were valued at $150,000 and you're looking to buy them for $120,000, $100,000, right now you should be looking for properties that are worth $150,000, that do not need a lot of work, ladies and gentlemen. I'm talking just paint and potentially floor replacement, but that does not need to be done urgently. You should be looking for that in the $75,000 to $110,000 range.
Wow. So that was a lot. I think that we've walked through a lot of information that Regine has laid out for, you know, what is the state of the union when we think about active real estate investing right now? how to dig in and talk to your tenants, reaching out, you know, what's a very human way to do that? How do you negotiate with them in these very challenging times? And then also thinking about Airbnb, fixing and flipping and wholesaling, what are some actions to do? And so a lot of information. I hope that everyone got a lot out of that. This is our, you know, week of, you know, build wealth. We're going to continue tomorrow. We're going to have Vineet Prasad from Savings Academy on, who's really going to talk to you. How do we go in and do a deep dive around our expenses, look at our income and understand, even in these tough times, how do we think about generating cash flow? Then we're going to have on Thursday, John V, who is the CEO, co-founder of Agent Risk, which is a robo-advisor who's going to talk to us about how do we bolster and make the best out of a bad situation in our stock portfolios. Friday, we're going to be joined by Joe Fairless, who is a friend and mentor who will give the state of the union and what's happening right now with multifamily on a much larger scale. And so thank you so much, Regine. Really appreciated you being on here today. And thank you for the inspiration for executing this. Any last things that you want to leave with our viewers today in our live, but not live?
I just want to say, just don't lose hope, guys. Traditionally, in downturns is when the largest wealth transfer happens and wealth is created. So you definitely want to keep your eyes open for opportunities, but you don't want to jump to conclusions or move too quickly. So hold on to your properties if you can. We buy and we hold. So hold those properties. And, you know, really stay focused on what's happening, on the positive things that are happening. Don't focus on the things that you can't do. Focus on the things that you can. You can contact your tenants. You can be empowered. You can contact your mortgage officer and you can find out what are some of the opportunities that are available to you to kind of mitigate that risk. You can ask for forbearance. You can ask for a repayment plan and you can talk to your tenants about that as well. This too shall pass. And we're going to be right here with you because like you, we're active and we're passive investors.
Thank you so much. It was a real pleasure and an honor to be with you again today. We'll see you tomorrow.
Thanks, guys. Onwards and wealthwards.
Onwards and wealthwards.